Good morning. Good morning, church. Very good to see all of your beautiful faces today. Thank you for joining us. We're so glad to get to lead you all in worship today. If you would like to and you're able, please join us and stand as we sing about the grace of our Father. Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with a sinner's restless heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart.
I've been asked to read from Matthew 25. I'll leave that there for now then. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The five who were foolish didn't take enough oil for their lamps, but the other 5 were wise enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they were roused by a shout, "Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him." All the bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. Then the 5 foolish ones asked the others, "Please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out." But the others replied, "We don't have enough for all of us. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves." But while they were gone to buy oil, the bridegroom came. Then those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was locked. Later, when the other 5 bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, "Lord, Lord, open the door for us." But he called back, "Believe me, I don't know you. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or hour of my return."
You guys are welcome to take a seat. Buenos dias. Welcome to Oak Park. We 16 of us just returned from Mexico, Vicente Guerrero, Baja California, Mexico, this morning at 12:30 a.m. after 20 hours of travel, and we were being chased out by a hurricane.
Yeah.
So it's nice to be home, but we had a fabulous week. And next week, our team will do our official, like, sharing some stories and some pictures and telling you more about our experience. But there are a few things coming up. It's a little bit of a busy time. So just want to let you know, August 27th, we will be sharing about Mexico during the service. But then after church, the youth will have their back-to-school kickoff lunch. So right after church, the youth have a big lunch. September 3rd will be after church, will be the church picnic directly after church. And then Saturday, September 9th at 10:30 a.m. will be the Breeze baby shower. We'll be officially welcoming little Emmeline and just blessing their family with some love and gifts. And there will be a lot more information about all of those things in the midweek news and, you know, in other forms. So be looking for those details. But also, you know, there are just a couple of crazy weather things going on right now, and I want to make sure that we pray. Last night, Camp White Branch was evacuated due to the fires that were coming close, and there were some winds that were expected to maybe pick up. I don't know the status this morning, but I'd love to pray for our camp. I know that it's been evacuated, so there's no one actually at camp. And then Welcome Home Outreach Ministries that we were just with in Mexico. The hurricane is coming through that area. We got a report this morning that so far they've just been having some light rain and light wind, which is wonderful to hear, and we are going to pray that that continues for them. So join me in prayer. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for this day. Thank you for all of these beautiful children of yours that have gathered here today to learn about you, to fellowship, to worship you. And God, we just lift up Camp White Branch and Welcome Home Outreach. And God, everything else in the path of these fires and these hurricanes. God, we ask you to remember your children, remember your people. God, remember your promises. I know that you do, and we thank you for that. God, your grace is enough, and we just ask for your grace to be with everyone in these situations. Comfort them. Let them know that you are there, that you are with them always, no matter what happens. Amen.
Nope, there it is. Okay. We have a second reading from Matthew. Verses 14 through 30, which is a second story about the kingdom of God. Again, the kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a long trip. He called together his servants and entrusted his money to them while he was gone. He gave 5 bags of silver to one, 2 bags of silver to another, and 1 bag of silver to the last, dividing it in proportion to their abilities. He then left on his trip. The servant who received the 5 bags of silver began to invest the money and earned 5 more. The servant with 2 bags of silver also went to work and earned 2 more. But the servant who received the 1 bag of silver dug a hole in the ground and hid the master's money. After a long time, their master returned from his trip and called them to give an account of how they had used his money. The servant to whom he had entrusted the 5 bags of silver came forward with 5 more and said, "Master, you gave me 5 bags of silver to invest, and I have earned 5 more." The master was full of praise. "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together." The servant who had received the 2 bags of silver came forward and said, "Master, you gave me 2 bags of silver to invest, and I have earned 2 more. The master said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together." Then the servant with the 1 bag of silver came and said, "Master, I knew you were a harsh man, harvesting crops you didn't plant and gathering crops you didn't cultivate. I was afraid I would lose your money, so I hid it in the earth. Look, here's your money back." But the master replied, "You wicked and lazy servant. If you knew I harvested crops I didn't plant and gathered crops I didn't cultivate, why didn't you deposit my money in the bank? At least I could have gotten some interest on it." Then he ordered, "Take the money from this servant and give it to the one with the 10 bags of silver. To those who use well what they are given, even more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who do nothing, even what little they have will be taken away. Now throw this useless servant into outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth."
That is so beautiful. I'm having a hard time not crying up here because hearing all your voices praising God together, it's so beautiful. So thank all of you very much for being here again. And we have so many reasons to thank God for everything he's given us and has brought us through and will bring us through. And we're going to sing about that now. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your songs again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the a lot about faithfulness. I got to pick the songs this week, and I wonder if these are for me. So I'm selfishly serving myself to bolster my own faith, but hopefully it does the same for all of you to remember his faithfulness even when things are hard, especially when they're hard. We were reminded today that his strength is made perfect in our weakness, so we are good. He is strong. So showing up strong today. So thank you, Father God, for your faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is
think we got it now. Good. The third scripture reading from Matthew 25 begins at verse 31. But when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit upon his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered in his presence, and he will separate the people as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you fed me. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me into your home. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you cared for me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then these righteous ones will reply, "Lord, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink, or a stranger and show you hospitality, or naked and give you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you?" And the king will say, "I tell you the truth. When you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me." And then the king will turn to those on the left and say, "Away with you, you cursed ones, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his demons. For I was hungry and you didn't feed me. I was thirsty and you didn't give me a drink. I was a stranger and you didn't invite me into your home. I was naked, and you didn't give me clothing. I was sick and in prison, and you didn't visit me." And then they will reply, "Lord, when did we ever see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and not help you?" And he will answer, "I tell you the truth. When you refused to help the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were refusing to help. And they will go away into eternal punishment. But the righteous will go into eternal life." God bless his word as we've shared it today.
Pray with me. Jesus, thank you for who you are. Thank you for both your words of compassion and the difficult words of judgment. God, would you just weave these three stories together for us this morning? Would you show us how they play off of one another? Will you show us how we can apply this kind of big picture to our lives? Will you give me the words and the images and the metaphors to nudge us in your direction, God? To nudge us to make investments that have eternal payoffs. God, would you also be with our finances, with our offerings, those things that are given in faith and in generosity, Lord, would you just multiply them for the sake of your world, for the sake of your kingdom, for the sake of those who are hungry and thirsty and sick. God, we love you and we dedicate all of our resources to you, Jesus. We thank you for this morning. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. And we ask for your guidance now. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, some of you may have walked in and you found a little card on your pew. So that is, I'm going to be doing a class this fall. I can't tell you all the details about the class because some of you know this, but I am supposed to have arthroscopic hip surgery on the 27th of September, which I would appreciate your prayers for. And the recovery is supposed to be pretty intense, and I don't know exactly. I don't want, what I'm trying to say is I don't want to tell you I'm going to be teaching a class such and such dates and then this surgery make it so that I can't do that. So sometime after September 27th, we're going to do this class. And it is going to be called Wait, What? And what I'm envisioning is we've all read through the Bible at some point, some passage of Scripture, and we've gone, wait, what? What did that mean? Or why would God say that? Or why would God do that? What on earth am I looking at here? And I just want to know what that is for you. I want you to fill out a card and say, here's a passage of Scripture, and maybe you don't know it right off the top of your head. Maybe just write a character that's in it, or write what you think maybe the title of the story is. But write it down, put it in the little brown baskets or in the box in the back, or hand it to me, and let me know what confuses you. What are you like, wait, why would God, fill in the blank. And obviously, I'm not going to be able to do everything that you request, but I am going to use these cards as a guide for which scriptures we go through in detail. So please fill those out, and I'll have them out for several weeks for you to fill out. Okay, so we read all of Matthew chapter 25, which I appreciate you listening to. We, I think, don't have a very high tolerance for listening to someone read. But man, those are some powerful passages. And what I want to do this morning is I want to show for you is that each of those passages, each of those stories, we normally take one at a time, right? We'll do a sermon on the 10 bridesmaids. We'll do a sermon on the parable of the talents. Now, the version we read called it bags of silver, but most translations will call it talents. And then we'll do another sermon, completely unrelated, on the sheep and the goats. And so, but they're all in this same passage. Let's see if my clicker will work today. There we go. Are all in this same chapter. And what happens is when you read in your Bible, there's a little bold headings in your Bible, right? And they look real important because they're bigger fonts and they're in bold print and they're not part of the Bible, right? People, much later, were like, well, here's the title of this story, and here's the title of this story. But I imagine that when Matthew is sitting down and he's inspired by the Spirit to recount all these stories about Jesus, for him, I think that much of his gospel is intertwined with meaning. And I think especially in this particular chapter, what I want to argue for you today, what I want to illustrate for you today, is that actually these play off of one another. And I think that the first story and the last story help us explain the middle story, the parable of the talents. In fact, I'm gonna try and illustrate for you why I think the way we typically interpret the parable of the talents might not help us very much. Most of you, I think, are used to me doing that sort of thing, but still, you might want to buckle up today, okay? But first, parable of the talents. Jesus is like, here, this guy gave some money, and the three servants, they all invested it one way or another. One invested it in a really smart way, one invested it in a less smart way, but still a smart way, and the other one invested it in the ground, right? Because we're always investing. No matter what you're given, no matter what you have, no matter what your resources are, they are invested right now. Maybe they're invested in the ground, and maybe not. So what I want to do, as a starting point, is I want to think about investment, all right? I want to think about investment. I want somebody, hopefully young, to come up here and help me illustrate investment with this extremely real $50,000 bill. So, not just real, extremely real. Do we have any teenagers in the room that would like to be a volunteer? Any teenagers? Lily, right? Yeah, come on up. I should have had you sign something before you came up here. I can't actually give you $50,000, but there you go. That you can frame that. It'll be worth something someday, I think. All right, so here's what we're going to do. I want you to imagine that you have a long-lost uncle, great-uncle, that you've met like one time, and for whatever reason, you must have had an amazing conversation with him, because when he died, he didn't leave anything to anybody else in your family, but he was like, Lily, you get $50,000, okay? But he put some strings on that $50,000. It's like it has to be invested in one of three ways, okay? First way is you can buy for yourself a fancy sports car, all right? Now, actually, this is probably not enough money for that, but, you know, forget that. It might have to be a used sports car. Or you can invest it in a retirement account, okay? How old are you? 15, perfect. That's going to help me. Or here's the third option, is that your uncle also owned a very barren, like wasteland sort of plot of ground, and you can use the $50,000 to reforest that plot of ground. And incidentally, if you do that, you also get to own the lot, the land, okay? So those are your three options. What do you think you would do with this $50,000 if those were your options? In a Roth IRA, oh my goodness. Wow. Okay, that's very specific. You must have been thinking about your retirement. All right. I have lots of thoughts about that, but okay. All right, so here, everything has a return on investment, okay? Everything has a return on investment. Let's see how she chose, all right? Because I went through way more math than I wanted to this week to come up with these numbers. All right, yes, I think I know who applauded. So if you'd have gone with the sports car and you'd owned it for 10 years, it would have cost you $115,000 on top of the $50,000. Yeah, total, it would have cost you $165,000 just to own the car for 10 years. The reason for that is the car does not return investment on all sorts of ways. Just in gas, it was like $65,000 in gas. Since it's a sports car, it gets like 17 miles to the gallon. If you average $4 a gallon, which is a little optimistic on my part for Oregon, but if you average $4 a gallon over 10 years, a certain amount of driving, it's going to cost you that much money. So it's going to be an instant gratification. Wow, look at this. It's going to elevate your status in front of everybody that you're around. They're going to be like, look at her car that she can't drive yet because she's 15. So that would have been option one. The option you chose is if you were eight, I did the math based off of being 18. If at the age of 18 you put your $50,000 into not a Roth IRA, but a regular sort of retirement account, and if you average 8% a year, which is doable, it happens, it would be $1.1 million at the age of 65, which, depending on inflation, would probably be a pretty good amount of money. And the last one, if you choose the land, now it's not actually worth an infinite amount. The reason I put the infinite up there is because it's so hard, because there's so many options with what you can do with the land, right? Because because you get this land and you're also reforesting it, you're making it beautiful and wonderful and amazing, you could divide it into subplots and sell each of those. You could build a family house on it after you've saved an enormous amount of money, or you take out a mortgage on building that house, or you could keep it for years and years, for generations, and then your grandchildren could be multimillionaires when they sell it. And so there's all sorts of ways in which this kind of investment is expansive, right? Okay, you can take your $50,000. Thank you, Lily, appreciate it. It was a well done, good and faithful servant choice. It's a lot easier not to choose the sports car when you're not looking at it, by the way. There's a return on investment for everything. And I think a lot of times, Lily is perhaps the exception, but a lot of times in life we are not very good at calculating the return on investment. We're not very good. And even these, I mean, if when you retire, as some of you know, it happens to be during a recession, this calculator might mean nothing to you. car, I think, is pretty standard. It's going to cost you a lot of money, no matter what the economic variables are. And land, too. Value of land fluctuates. The reason I chose the land, though, as an option is because it had this baked-in incentive, right? That something about this far-off fictional uncle wants to sort of have a carrot for you. If you'll go this route that has this long-term vision, then there'll be this added investment, this added thing for you. It's almost like the great uncle is saying, yeah, you can do these things, but this is the one you should do. And I think when we read the parable of the talents, that's what's there, and we kind of miss it. So keep all this in your brain as we keep rolling forward. The parable of the talents, is it really about talents? Because that's what we, or at least for my whole life, that's the way I've heard it preached, right? Is that God has given you talents and gifts, and you need to go and you need to use those talents and gifts. And if you don't use that talent or gift, it's like burying it in the ground. Here's why I think that is a little bit problematic. You can enrich your talents without honoring God, right? You can enrich your talents. You can invest your talents in a way where they multiply and your skills expand, and it does not bring the kingdom of God on earth. In fact, a lot of times, for a lot of people through whom their talents become expansive, they move further and further away from being interested in the kingdom of God, which is what this parable is about, and more interested in the kingdom of self. And here's the other thing about this, is that we get the word talent from this story. The word talent means an enormous amount of money. It does not mean a gift. It does not mean skills. It does not mean abilities. It just means an enormous amount of money. One talent or five talents, which is what the, I messed it up. Five talents would have been $150,000. So the one servant is given $150,000. Now the thing that's real different about this versus my little game here is that the uncle is dead and gone. You're not accountable to the uncle. But in Jesus' story, it's a master who has gone away on a journey and plans to come back. And so I think the thing we have to ask ourselves is, what does the master want when he returns? What is he looking for? What kind of investment pleases the master? Is it that I'm really gifted at a sport and I'm going to keep getting better at that sport and that's how I'm going to bring glory to the master? That, I mean, as an athlete when I was in high school, I loved this story for that very reason. It was like, oh, this is just permission to run more, right? This is not about that. And we cheapen our children's spirituality when we make it about that. Really, we do. We lie to them. We lie to them when we make it about that. And it's heartbreaking when once you realize God does not actually care, Matt, how fast you are. God cares about other things, like how you treat people, how you wait on God's presence when you're running. This is very difficult for us because we are an achievement-driven culture. Scripture and the gospel is not achievement driven. And so what we do when we interpret this passage through talents is we take our achievement culture and we put that on or over or on top of the passage. But I think we have to go back and we have to ask ourselves, what is the character of the master? What is it that he wants from us? Since we don't have bags of silver, when he returns, what is it that he's looking for? What is it that he's hoping that we have expanded and multiplied, since it's not about silver? The answer to that is the story before and the story after. If you want to have a return on investment that pleases the master, he has baked it into the story and said for you, here's what I want. If you'll just do this, I'll give you that lot of land. If you'll just do this, it will benefit you for eternity. Here, I'm giving you a roadmap. Here are the things that have eternal return on investment. If you don't want to bury your bag of silver in the ground, look to these two stories. Here's the first story. Let's recount it a little bit because I know it's been a while. Maybe you for anyway. There's a wedding happening. Bridesmaids are waiting in the street. They're apparently going to do some sort of processional when the groom shows up. I was very confused by the word bridegroom until I was like 21, 22, basically around the time when I got married and realized that that was me. I was the bridegroom. I was like, it was a very strange word for me. How can you be the bride and groom at the same time? So bridegroom means groom, all right? Groom. So they're waiting on the groom to show up, and apparently they're gonna parade him in to the wedding, all right? Now, historians tell us that we know almost nothing about weddings in Jesus' lifetime. Like, we don't really know what was the ceremony, what was the vows that people took, what were the rituals that went along with it. But what we do know is that grooms did not show up at midnight for the wedding. Right? Like, that is just a very strange component of this story. So the bridesmaids are all waiting, and it's so late that they've fallen asleep. And then the groom shows up in the middle of the night. And then there's a feast, apparently ready to be had, again, in the middle of the night. And apparently these foolish bridesmaids are foolish enough to think that there are oil shops open in the middle of the night for them to go to. Like, Jesus is not painting a normal wedding picture, which I think is an extremely important clue for us. Anytime you're reading the Bible and something is like, well, that's weird, normally it's weird on purpose. Normally it's weird on purpose. Normally it's illustrating some sort of point. And I think the point is that five of the bridesmaids, the wise ones, have said to themselves, this is so important that I'll spend extra money on extra oil just to make sure that I'm ready when the groom shows up. I'm looking forward so much to the arrival of the groom, I need to be prepared for all occasions. I mean, what if he shows up at midnight? I mean, that's crazy. Of course, he's not going to show up at midnight, but just in case, I'm going to bring extra oil, which I think gives us a sense of devotion. Well, I mean, Jesus even says, like, be prepared, keep watch. Like, that's absolutely the point of this story. But I don't think we are going to keep watch unless we have affection for the groom and his arrival. I think there has to be a motivating factor to say to yourself, I'm going to invest in extra oil, which, by the way, does not seem like a good investment, does it? Because why would the groom show up at midnight? That seems like bad advice. That seems like digging a hole in the ground and burying, as my mom used to say, why don't you, when I would tell her what I was going to spend my money on, she'd be like, why don't you just burn the cash, right? Just be more fun. Just go out there. I'll give you the $10. You just burn it in the backyard. And that's probably, somebody would be like, I mean, the foolish ones might have even, you know, goaded them and be like, come on, he's not going to show up at midnight. What kind of groom does that? And what kind of bride is going to wait around that long? But there's this, I think there's this affection, this devotion. I'm here at all costs. I'm here at all costs, and I'm trusting that the groom's arrival will be worth the investment in the extra oil. And I think I think that when we read that parable of the talents, and you have the one servant who put it in investment and got the two, he doubled his, right? He had two, got two more. I imagine that as the servant who was like, I'm going to live a life of devotion so that when the master comes back, I'm ready. What I've poured my heart and my soul and my resources into is a prayerful watchfulness for the master's return. And I don't think that's about, you know, the Left Behind series or the rapture or reading Revelation. I really think it's much more to do with this devotional attitude of, I'm here for you, Jesus. I'm here for your presence. I'm looking for you. I am in love with you, and I've set aside my resources so that even in the crazy event that you show up in the middle of the night when no groom would dare do, can you imagine if I'd have been late to my wedding, right? No, even if I'm ready for you, Jesus. That's like taking a bag of silver and saying, going to invest it. And just like everything else Jesus basically tells his followers to do, it's the crazy investment that works, right? It's not the common sense investment. I mean, can you think of a single time in any of the four Gospels where the Pharisees were like, oh yeah, Jesus, that makes sense. Yeah, that's what we all thought. Why'd you say it? We get it. Well, let's just do what everybody else does. And so I think that if we're going to invest in a way that pleases the master upon his return, we might have to buy some extra oil, even if it looks silly to those around us. But there's another story in here about the sheep and the goats. This is an intense story too about investment. You might know that in several other places, Jesus says something to the effect of, you need to love this person knowing that they're not going to love you back. Right? When he tells them to love their enemies, it's not because you're going to get a reward here. When he tells them to love their enemies, it's not because you're going to get a reward here. It's a little bit like that land. But actually, to get the biggest payoff for the land is to not sell it for yourself, but to hold on to it for another generation or another generation, and to never see the return on investment for yourself. And I think that's at least part of what we read in this passage. There's this compassion. This compassion that Jesus calls forth as, you want an eternal return on investment? Live a life of servanthood. If you want to take your five talents and turn them into 10, go to the hungry and the thirsty. And stranger, by the way, it means foreigner. It's not like somebody I don't know. It's the word xenos, which has to be somebody who's an immigrant, somebody who's not from wherever they are. Okay, so it's not the person across the street who you don't know their first name. It's a traveler from a distant country. So the hungry, the thirsty, the foreigner, the naked, the sick, and the prisoner. Now in some cases, some of those people are going to be able to pay you back. Some of those people will want to pay you back. Once they're released from prison and life has changed for them, they might return to you and fall down on their knees and say, thank you so much for visiting me. Or someone who was sick and you took care of them and then they get better, they might return the favor when you get sick. But most of the time, and some of us can get rather bitter about this, and I'm putting myself in this category, most of the time you don't get a thank you here. You don't get a return on investment in this life. You just plant the seed of God's compassion, of God's mercy, and you move forward. And you never even hear. You never even know. The person moves on. The person's circumstances change. They move away. You never hear from them again. And you're left to wonder. You may be left to wonder, was that an investment that was wise with my resources? And I think part of the reason Jesus tells us this story is so that we'll have some faith that yes, every single time that you act and love in servanthood to those who cannot repay you, it has an eternal reward beyond imagination. So we're supposed to be people who, when he gives us the bag of silver, or the five bags of silver, we don't look at the world and say, man, what will gain me status? What will gain me the approval of others? What will fill my own pockets with this bag of silver? What will expand my church? What will expand my reach and my influence in society? We're supposed to look at the bags of silver and say, how do I honor the heart of Jesus with this? Knowing that it may never return to me until the breath is exhausted in my lungs. And I stand before him in judgment. And he looks at me and says, well done, faithful, good and faithful servant. You've taken five bags and turned them into ten. You've taken five bags and turned them into ten. By looking at the people who the world says, that's a terrible investment. That earns you nothing. By having Jesus' eyes for what is a good investment, for who is a good investment. As a bit of a side note, I guess, I think as I was reading these passages this week, it really struck me more than maybe ever before that the servant who buries the money in the ground, why did he bury the money in the ground? Because he was afraid of the master. Now, it's like the Bible tells us to fear the Lord. The beginning of wisdom is fear of the Lord. I think, though, that normally that means respect. It means awe. It means an understanding that God is beyond me, and I will fade like the grass in the field. But this servant is terrified of God, terrified of the master. And that terror actually paralyzes him, actually paralyzes him. Every once in a while over the years, people will say, why do you preach about love all the time? Why do you preach about mercy all the time? Part of the reason even these passages, they are hard judgment passages, right? But I think if we land there, if that's where we were like, okay, the point of all this is be afraid of God, what that actually will do is paralyze us. We'll forget to go and get oil. We'll forget to live that life of devotion. We'll forget or be too distracted by trying to please God to see the people created in the image of God right on our doorstep, on our street corners, to our neighbors, to our right and our left, our brothers and sisters in the room. We'll be so focused on how do I please God. This is one of those things that I really don't want you to hear me say that I'm better than some other kind of Christian, but I also feel compelled that if I don't say these things, then I don't help you learn, okay? So I'll do the best I can here. But I have known a lot of Christians who are terrified of God. I have known a lot of Christians who are terrified of God. And out that terror causes them to attend church every week. That terror causes them to read their Bible all the time. That terror causes them to invest in ways that feel like they please God and please others. And when I invite them, hey, come to this place where we're serving these people who can't repay us. Well, I'm busy with this other Christian thing that's going to please God. Because I got to please God because he reaps where he does not sow. Okay. I mean, if that's where you are, that's where you are. But I think the other two servants didn't say a word about terror. There's this almost, I think, in the way that Chad read it, I kind of heard this, hey, look, I've got another 5 bags of gold for you, 5 bags of silver. There's this jubilation, this joy at having invested the talents in a way that they know is going to please God, to please the master. So what will you do with your resources? We've each been given at least a bag of silver, spiritually speaking. And there are way more than 3 options for us. You can do all sorts of things with the resources. And by the way, your talents are included in it, right? But it's not the point of the story. The resources you've been given, what are you going to do with it? Is it going to be just an act of duty? Just going to show up, make sure that my behind is in the pew because I'm afraid, because I have to do it, because I have a duty to do it? I think we can take away from these 3 stories that is foolishness. That is burying our talents in the ground. Are we going to take our resources and say, how do I show my affection for God with these things? How do I be like the bridesmaid who says, I'm going to wait into the wee hours of the night and be ready, even if the bridegroom shows up at a really weird time? I'm going to have this devotion of heart, this life of prayer, this life of seeking the presence of God. And I think this story says to us that has eternal significance, an eternal, limitless return on investment. And of course, I think if we take our resources and we say, I want to live a life of servanthood, I want to wash the feet of those who can't wash mine, I want to visit the sick, hungry, and the thirsty, and the prisoner. I love that prisoner is in there, because you can make a case for all the other ones being worthy of it, right? Not that prisoners aren't worthy, but we think of prisoners as they've gotten the thing they deserve, or we hope. No, go visit them. Pour out mercy and love on those who you think don't deserve it. And so if you do that, if you take your resources and you say, I will live a life where I am investing these bags of silver that the master has given me in those who the world says is a terrible, terrible investment, there will be this eternal return. That will never gain you glory here, because pretty much for all of human history, those folks have been looked on as horrible investments. Basically every culture, basically every place, every time, the prevailing assumption is don't invest in them. And Jesus says, you've got foolishness and wisdom mixed up. If you want to reap an eternal reward, live a life of devotion. Live a life of servanthood. Jesus says this in Matthew 6, in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal. Could we not say that's a bit like a hole in the ground that earns nothing? But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. There your heart will be also. Let's pray. Jesus, these three passages are both so full of things that could discourage us and things that could give us hope. Jesus, I just pray that you would invite us into that place of hope. I pray that your Spirit would just give us a flood of creativity for how we could invest our finances, our gifts, our talents, our weaknesses, everything that we have, our relationships, how we could invest those things in living a life of devotion for you, where we're waiting up and we're ready for your presence, and living a life of servanthood for you, where we're looking for your image in those who are downtrodden and left behind and forgotten and struggling. God, would you give us eyes to see how we could be invited into that work to invest in a way that pleases you, to invest in a way that honors your character, and to invest in a way that follows kind of the trail that you set for us, or how we ought to invest. God, we love you. We adore you. We wait for you. And we long to serve you and our neighbors. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good.
For the first 17 years of my life, every Sunday night, my dad would go to the county jail, and my mom and I would go to Sunday evening church together. And my dad would go to the jail to teach GED courses for the men who had found themselves in the jail, and I hated it. I just hated that he didn't get to come to church with us. I hated that he had to stop playing baseball with me. I hated that he had to cut loose and go and do this thing, and it drove me nuts. Because it felt, as a little boy, it felt like a horrid investment, Dad. What are you doing? Why aren't you spending all your time with me? And I found, after my dad died, I found a letter from right in the midst of that age when I was like 6 or 7 years old, and he said in the letter to my mom, "Man, I feel so humiliated by all of our friends who make so much more money than I do and who have so much more to offer the world and whose skills are so much more used and honored." And so even he was struggling to figure out, how do I keep investing in this thing that the world just looks at as, why are you doing that? What's the point? It's just a waste of your time. But I just imagine, I just had this moment when he did pass away. I just had this vision of him with bags of silver. "Here's what I did with what you gave me, God." All these people that he invested in for 17 years. And so the world will tell you, the world will tell you to forget about the least of these. Forget about the extra oil. I just hope that the Spirit will whisper to you today, there is eternal goodness in staying the course of following Jesus, of devoting yourself to him, and to serving those who can't serve you back. Because the return on investment is innumerable and eternal. May you go being and feeling invited into such a wondrous and eternal work. Have a great week.